after the game in Major League Baseball Network's Peter Gammons joins us now. And Peter is a very old friend of mine, guys, so I'm happy to have him on. Peter, thank you for rearranging your travel day for us.
Oh, I'm very happy to. It's good to you. Every day you have at least one guest who was at your wedding.
I know, seriously. I mean, we can talk about that. At least you know that we had a great, great bar. We had good appetizers, yep. Right? It was a good evening.
It was a tremendous evening.
And you were there to watch Rich Eisen. Again, I'm Suzy Shuster sitting in for Rich Eisen. You were there, Peter, to watch Rich Eisen sing with a 15-piece orchestra.
Yes.
So not everybody can say that when they call into the Rich Eisen show that I did watch Rich perform Sinatra at his wedding. But you and Gloria were there, and that meant a lot to us. And now, of course, I get to go from the beautiful segment and the turn here. How do you get from asking Peter Gammons, from talking about your wedding and Sinatra to a chickenpox outbreak with the Royals? I wish I could figure out a smooth way of doing that, but Peter, I will just say to you, what the hell is happening in Kansas City?
That is a really strange thing. I mean, I don't remember, I don't ever remember a chickenpox outbreak. I mean, I think it's something to be feared because, as you know, I mean, there are, if you had chickenpox as a kid, you can end up with, there are a number of different diseases you can get later or conditions that can show up when you're older. So it's something to be concerned about. You just, for their sake, I hope that they're able to quarantine the two players and avoid this becoming a serious issue going on into October.
But, you know, you have to think about this, the timing of it all. With the best record in the American League, with Kelvin Herrera going down and so much of their bullpen is and how this team is built around those flamethrowers later in the game, how will this affect the Royals right now?
I think what at least they have is they have a month before the playoffs begin. I think the playoffs start on the 6th of October. So they have time and, you know, I don't think it's a problem unless it has spread. And that they weren't quarantined in time, and other players come down with it, and this thing kind of drags on. I think that's the concern that the Royals have. But it's just, you know, sometimes it was almost too easy for the Royals. I mean, this is a city that hasn't had a team finish first since 1985, and it's one of those. This is too good a season. We have the best team in the American League, and now we were hit by chickenpox. It's not like Tommy John surgery. So it's just they have to wait for a couple of weeks and see what happens and hope that nobody else comes down.
Peter Gammons joining us from MLB Network. I am Suzy Shuster in for Rich Eisen. I suppose you could go from a town that's so excited about their team to asking you directly about the Mets because so many people in New York are waiting for the bubble to burst there. You know, they've got this exciting young staff, one of the most exciting young staffs in all of baseball, in their pitching. If Terry Collins had to win one game, who would he hand the ball to?
DeGrom. I think that he would be the guy. I think DeGrom would be their guy to pitch that one game. If they had to have a playoff, let's say the Nationals and the Mets tied for first place, but neither one had a good enough record to be the wild card. They weren't as good as their record wasn't as good as the Pirates or the Cubs. Then, you know, I think you would see that. I think it would be if he lined up, it would be Jacob DeGrom. I mean, I say that I love Harvey and Syndergaard and so forth, but I really think that DeGrom is very close to that elite group with Bumgarner and Greinke and, you know, and Kershaw. I mean, I think he's right in that group right now.
What's your instinct? How long do you think the Mets will last into the postseason?
I think they'll go a long way. I think they're very dangerous. I sort of did like a little informal, not for media, poll of general managers about this. And I think I got more votes on the Pirates will go the furthest. Than the Mets. My tendency is to say I think it'll be the Mets. I worry about the Cardinals' bullpen having been pitched too much during the season. I know why, but I worry about that come October. And I think the Mets are really dangerous. I also think the Dodgers, if Kershaw and Greinke are as good as I think they will be this time around, even if they only have two or three relievers, I think the Dodgers will be dangerous because I think that the players who really care will end up playing, and just going out and getting Utley will change the frame. Sort of the mentality of that clubhouse. I thought it was fascinating last night watching Jock Peterson run around the bases at full speed, doing something that Chase Utley would do. And I just wonder, you know, my watching it, I went, I think Chase Utley has already impacted some people on that team.
Well, yeah, having a veteran influence come in right now will definitely shape the direction of this team.
Oh, definitely. And he is, I mean, not only is he a phenomenal person, but he is so serious and plays so hard that I think that he's got a presence about him that it creates natural respect. And I think it'll really rub off. I think they needed that sort of guy in the Dodgers. And, you know, I mean, he does play hard all the time. He runs everything out. And I think, too, seeing someone who always runs the bases really well. I mean, I'm kidding. The Dodgers sometimes is a team on the bases like Ruben Rivera. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, I think that helps in itself. And I think he kind of gives them that player-manager on the field. And I think that's really important. I don't think there's anybody happier in America to have Chase Utley in Los Angeles than Don Mattingly.
Well, that leads me to ask you, Peter. He is, of course, Rich Eisen's idol, Don Mattingly. How much pressure is there on Don to bring this whole thing home?
I think there's quite a bit. I mean, I don't view it as his problem. Some of the issues they have in the clubhouse are not of his doing. The issues he have with the bullpen are not his doing. But at the same time, I mean, when you're managing a really bad, what you bring in, it's going to be the wrong decision. I think Andrew would back him up. I really believe that. But at the same time, there is a lot of pressure on it. But he'll never back down from anything. And by the way, that's the right guy to have for an idol.
Oh, are you kidding? Our daughter's middle name is Mattingly. Do you know that?
Oh, no, that's tremendous.
Oh, yeah.
You know what's great was, until about 5 years ago, he still lived in the same house that he built in Evansville when he was in the minor leagues. Now, here he was, the star of New York. He is no different today than what he was when he was an ambidextrous high school quarterback in Evansville.
You actually are able to give me a good transition to Matt Williams with the Nationals, because I'm curious about him and how his team's collapse will affect him, because they were earlier in the season a lock for the playoffs.
Yeah, it's been really hard on Matt. And again, I mean, he is such a good man. I feel badly for him. I mean, there are times their bullpen has also been terrible, and there have been times when you kind of go, what is he going to do here? I think that they will be calling for scalps in Washington. Tom Boswell wrote a brilliant column yesterday, and it was that everybody's talking about injuries or Matt Williams, whatever. Is the real story is the myth of the Washington Nationals. They're not that good. They're not as good as the Mets have the best pitching. The Washington pitching is allowing a running game more this year than they did last year. So therefore, and the Mets pitching has been sensational. And I thought Boz really, for writing in Washington, I thought it was just a tremendous column on sort of this is why the Nationals are where they are. And when you take it in that context, you kind of go, it's pretty hard for the Mets to not win this thing. But we shall see. I know, but the Mets, people in the front office and fans are still thinking about 2006, 2007. So there's a little fear and paranoia in both franchises right now.
Oh, history, as you know, can be the enemy with the Mets. And I guess it's a good reason to go from the Mets and history being the enemy to the Red Sox. I'm curious, I'd be remiss not to ask you about Dave Dombrowski. How do you feel about his hiring?
Well, I think it works if it's just Dave Dombrowski and John Henry. If there are too many other owners trying to put their fingers into it, make 11:30 at night calls to general managers saying, why didn't we make this trade? Then it'll still be chaos. I think the strength that Dave has is, I mean, not only has he been a very good executive, his last 10 years with the Tigers were the most successful in terms of wins, revenues, and position of any Tiger team in history in a 10-year block. But I think his relationship with John Henry is so strong that when some of the other owners start calling in the middle of the night, he can just block the calls. And I think that's really important because Boston is tough enough to begin with. The issue is going to be who he brings in as general manager, who will actually be working for him, more of an assistant general manager, is really important because they have a phenomenal baseball operations group. But if they bring the wrong guy in from outside, half that group will be gone in a week. And they've already lost a couple of people, but there could be a massive invasion to places like Chicago and Pittsburgh if the wrong guy comes in.
And you know Theo Epstein always has his eye on people that have experienced the Red Sox front office.
Yes. Well, he's really built a phenomenal organization. And not surprising, but there are a few more people that in that front office who would go work for him in a second, and for Neil Huntington in Pittsburgh.
Well, that's what Chris Brockman and I were talking about this morning. I still have to wonder why they let Theo go, if it was just a personality clash or egos or what it was.
Well, there was such a confusing time at the end of 2011 when they blew the 10-game lead in September. And they fired Terry Francona, but they didn't really tell him they fired him. And they had this awkward press conference where everybody knew Francona was gone, but the owners wouldn't admit it. And, I mean, it was really bizarre. And Phil Theo had the opportunity to go to Chicago for a much better job and took off. And Ben Cherington took the brunt of what didn't work. Ben was a major part of that. But the ironic thing is that now as they get into the first week of September, they have very close to the best young team in the American League on the field because they're letting the young players play. Some of the pitchers that struggled for them for half a year have now absolutely figured it out with some of the system that they're using. If this team had done this for the last, what they've done the last 3 weeks, starting at the All-Star break, there never would have been any changes. But it's also bizarre because a lot of people were never really told what was going on. So it's been pretty strange place to be around. I mean, they fired Don Orsillo, their play-by-play announcer.
It's crazy.
Immensely popular. Now, Tom Werner fired him, not the people in Essen. And then Werner was quoted in the paper yesterday as saying he's upset because he wanted it to be announced in late January. But, A, nothing gets, as you know, nothing is kept a secret in Boston.
Nothing.
For like 5 months. And secondly, that would have meant that he's saying, well, we wanted Don Orsillo not to have a job for next season.
Nothing is a secret in Boston, Peter. You know that better than anyone. Nothing is ever a secret. It's on the green line within 30 seconds. Peter, nobody fills a segment like you do. Thank you so much for calling in, and thanks for rearranging your day.
Great to talk to you, Suzy.
Oh, it's such a pleasure. Say hi to Gloria.
I will. Okay.
That was Peter Gammons from MLB Network.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern. On Audience.